वेलकम एवरीवन, वेलकम टू आवर 10th मीटिंग ऑफ एसएपी स्टैम्प टू इंडिया। सो वी आर हियर फॉर आवर 10th मीटिंग। सो बैकग्राउंड फॉर एवरीबॉडी, वी स्टार्टेड दिस गौरव नबी देन फ्यू ऑफ द मेंबर्स, वी स्टार्टेड दिस मंथली मीटिंग टू हैव एवरीबॉडी ऑन वन पेज, टू हैव एवरीबॉडी कनेक्ट ऑन मंथली बेसिस, टू डिस्कस फ्यू ऑफ द टॉपिक्स। वी विल हैव सम स्मॉल प्रेजेंटेशंस in every meeting where we will talk about latest topics. Those topics will be decided by everybody in the meeting, the agenda. So this meeting is for everyone. Everybody is free to join. It's not a formal meeting. It's a kind of collection of people, of like-minded people who want to learn new things, who want to understand, who want to get together and go through new topics every week. So today we will have one interesting session on SAP BTP, which will be delivered by Pranav. And then today we will not have our second session. Today we have decided to keep the house open. So today we will have that 30-40 minutes of an open discussion where everybody can ask their questions about new technologies or even some old technologies. Whatever topic they want to discuss relevant to SAP, we will discuss that topic. So it will be an open house where we expect a healthy discussions on any of the new topics or anything we want to discuss about SAP. That's it. And then we will discuss about our next topic. We will ask the community to nominate themselves for the topics and even nominate for topics on what they want to deliver. So moving ahead, I would give the baton to Mohit. Mohit, maybe you can introduce Pranav.
Just to add to what Akash has mentioned, yeah, we have today the second slot open for questions. The idea was, since our first topic is so interesting, BTP for beginners, it was one topic which actually community voted for as well. So Pranav is very knowledgeable in BTP. He has been working hands-on on BTP. He has a very good overview on the BTP as well, of different services and all. So idea is that we should not be rushing for time for the second session if we have a lot of questions on this BTP topic. And we expect that there could be many discussions happening on it. So yeah, feel free to ask your question regarding BTP, anything. You want to ask, Pranav would be there, many other people would be there, so let's utilize that time as well.
Mohit, you can...
Yeah. Hi Akash, hello everyone. So as Gaurav and Akash mentioned, we have one very wonderful session planned for the SAP BTP, and as they have mentioned, it is one of the topic that many of our community members are continuously asking, and it is one of the topic we want to explore as much as possible, and all the SAP latest development and all the latest happenings are moving across for the BTP related stuff. So this time we have Pranav Nagpal, who has really very good knowledge on the SAP BTP stuff. He is working extensively on the SAP BTP from last 5-6 years, when it is called actually HANA Cloud Platform, then slowly it has been called to SAP Cloud Platform, and now it is SAP Business Technology Platform. So we will have a really good time with Pranav to understand the different aspects from the BTP services point of view, to understand the overall architecture, and to understand what is happening and what is the BTP required for our enterprise, what BTP can reach our SAP platform. So just to give a quick introduction about Pranav, like, he has 14 years of experience, is currently working as a technical architect in Infosys and based out of Switzerland now, and working for one of the very big SAP S/4HANA implementation of project. Apart from this, he has very good understanding of all the enterprise portal, BTP administration, all the Fiori. I think Fiori is working from the last 7-8 years, the time when SAP had started SAP Fiori. So he has overall very good background for all the flavors of all the latest happenings in the BTP, all the latest happening in the UI side by side extension. So without any further delay, let's welcome him. and let's directly hear from him. Yeah, so over to you, Pranav. Yeah, please.
Thank you, Akash, Mohit, Gaurav. Thank you very much. So I hope I'm audible clearly. If I'm not, just let me know. You can stop me anywhere if you like to discuss anything. And yes, I'll put this in presentation mode. So starting off, as people introduced, my name is Pranav Nagpal, and I have been working on SAP BTP, formerly SAP Cloud Platform, from past few years now. I will guide you through this session on BTP for beginners. Now, before we start, I would like to give you a glimpse of what we will cover in next half an hour or 45 minutes. So I will give you an overview on BTP. How does and where does it stand in the intelligent enterprise strategy of SAP? Then gain some insights into platform. What exactly platform looks like from hands-on perspective. And then a small demo that would be more interactive, I assume, because it's more from the platform perspective, and wherever you have questions, we can try to cover. And I hope I will be able to answer some of your questions, if not all. But because we have a community here, we can answer questions which I'm not able to answer by anyone inside. So it's open to all. Okay, to start it off, let's take a look into SAP strategy. SAP Intelligence Suite is totality of SAP business application, such as S/4HANA or SuccessFactor, right? So, and that helps customer run end-to-end business processes and use new technologies to drive the business outcomes. So in addition, and with the help of SAP ecosystem, SAP and SAP partners can deliver vertical solutions for different industries as part of SAP Industry Cloud. Probably you've heard the name Industry Cloud before. And the foundation of all these solutions is SAP BTP. If you see here in the slide, let me see if I can make a pointer out of it. Just give me a minute. Okay, I'm not sure if pointer is available. Okay, so this is the, if you can see my mouse, this is the place where the Industry Cloud's solution will sit, right? And if you see down system below, it's BTP. So BTP is kind of a base on which the Industry Cloud solutions are to be built. It's by either by SAP or by partners or by customers directly, right? So with high development efficiencies and built on stable multi-cloud foundation, the BTP enables SAP and partners and customers to integrate, create value from data, and even extend the current SAP landscape. What does it mean is, when you cover the end-to-end processes, not every process is covered inside standard S/4HANA end-to-end, right? So example, if I'm saying market to cash, so it's the entire process is not covered directly inside HANA. So it's covered when we start from sales order creation. But before that, what happens is not inside S/4HANA. Now, this is where the opportunity arises, where we need to integrate either SAP products with S/4HANA or any other third-party products, right? So this is where the capability of integration comes into picture. We can use BTP, we can use direct integrations with S/4HANA. CPI is one of the options. And event-based integration is another option. So BTP, I don't know if you've heard, but BTP also provides event mesh, which is capturing the events from different places and then creating kind of a system where you can have all the events at one place. And then from there, the events can be distributed to or published to, let's say, S4HANA or coming out of S4HANA to any other procurement system, for example, GEP. Right? So, then data value, right? So data value is coming into picture because the BTP as a platform also provides a data warehouse or a SAP HANA service, which is a database in itself. And then you can probably have your analytics running on that database. So it's a HANA database, and therefore all the capabilities of HANA is via CDS views or CAPM or data warehouse. So I'm not sure how exactly it works, but you can have all the capabilities of HANA and run a direct analytics over it using, let's say, SAC. Right? So then extension suite. So extending the application. Now, I'm not saying the term as of now, but extending S4. So example, if S4 is not covering any specific functionality which is required by business, so that can be, and if it's a complete gap which is outside of a business process, that entire gap can be built side by side on our platform or BTP. And way is access is BTP has its own launchpad, and which is a central launchpad in terms of wider vision. And from there, it integrates S4. So the entire content you are building side by side, the small applications and the content of S4 is coming onto a central launchpad. So it becomes a central place where you have the extensions on standard processes and as well as the standard processes on one single page to make it easier for users to access. Okay, so BTP, before I jump into more capabilities, let us understand what does the platform in context of BTP is meant. So BTP is more than a development or a marketplace platform, but it's a combination of both. So in industry terms, it is product extension platform. So what it means, it provides business specific tooling for different developer personas. So example, it has, we have possibilities to create a UI for application. We can integrate HANA DBs. We can create workflows. We can create business rules, event mesh. And there are a lot, right? And launchpad services. I mean, it's a limitless of possibilities that we have. Then it allows partners to commercialize their solution via industry cloud, as I said earlier. Then it allows the extension of the digital core and like S4 and build integrations, use data analytic tools, as I said earlier, with SAC. So in totality, it's not one platform either to develop or to kind of a marketplace, but it's more kind of a product extension platform, which is more community driven. So more and more people join in the platform, and it becomes more mature. It is more available to for developers, for customers, for partners. More services are coming up and more closer to enterprise vision of cloud platform. Then people ask questions like, if AWS is already there, then why do we need BTP? So BTP is a cloud platform, yes, like AWS, but it also provides enterprise-ready application suite. So it's example, Event Mesh is there, CPI is there, then SAC is there, direct integrations to HANA DBs are there. So all these services are enterprise-ready. You don't have to write a very low-level code to integrate those services. And now new things are coming up. AppGiver is coming up, which is no-code, low-code, right? So a lot of things are evolving on this platform, and this makes it more enterprise-ready. It makes it more easier for us to develop or make our applications into production in a very agile way, in a very quick manner. We can even have, let's say, a simple UI5 CAPM application going into production in a month, right? So it is not necessary even following SAP release cycle, which is very bureaucratic in SAP world, right? So traditionally, ECCs will have their own dates of release dates, probably every quarter or every half year. But with BTP, I mean, you can leave all those bureaucracy outside in the ECC world and make it more agile, make applications go into production probably 2 weeks, right? So if you follow the entire DevOps architecture, or if you follow the entire cycle of developments and operations. So that's where the BTP benefits come into picture. I will pause on this. Any questions?
No, I think we don't even have something on the chat. We can continue.
Okay, I'm not seeing the chat, so if you can
ask me. Yeah, I'll take you.
Okay. Now that we know what kind of platform BTP is, let's come back to the bigger picture and look into core technologies it offers. So it brings together various SAP technologies from four major areas, as you can see over here, which is part of platform experience. So the first one, which is database and data management, right? So this is where SAP. Then second one is more from the analytics perspective, with primary solution being SAP Analytics Cloud. And then there are other options like business objects, BI, and BW for HANA. Then the third option, the third is development and integration. And fourth one is, so development and integration is nothing but where you can develop your applications. You can have your UEFI applications or CAPM applications, extend the S4 solution, and probably, I mean, even if you don't want to have UEFI, you can even have, let's say, some other technologies, probably a React-based application, right? But you, for that, you have to have certain packages on your BTP. So all those things will come into picture. But mainly in enterprise, we use UEFI to be more closer to SAP. Then fourth one is the intelligent technologies, such as AI business services or SAP IRPA. So IRPA is also very interesting, right? Because it's again evolving platform. Like what has happened, and I always relate it to what has happened in past for Fiori. So Fiori was launched with 1,000 applications to start with. And then it has created its own big bull of itself, right? So now there are 10,000 of apps in Fiori library. And every industry has specific, or every transaction in SAP, almost every transaction in SAP have its own corresponding applications. Not necessary that every transaction is equal to a Fiori application, but probably some of the features of every transaction comes into Fiori application. Similarly is happening with SAP IRPA. So SAP is bringing some standard bots with IRPA, which is catering to some of the standard functionalities in S4HANA. And probably I don't have the entire vision of it, but probably when I relate it, it's going into the same direction of Fiori, right? So SAP is starting with a smaller set, and over time it's going to evolve. Probably we will see a lot of IRP cases in future. So it's a very interesting tool to learn for. Now BTP delivers this unified experience for integration value, for data and extensibility, with all the features that I talked about. Now, this offers the interoperability with various SAP applications and the functional areas also. So what it means is, as I said earlier, right? So not everything is covered inside S4HANA. So there are some SaaS solutions which SAP bring up, and then there are solutions with S/4HANA core. Now, in combination, the example, SAP Advanced Cash Application, right? I am not able to recall the name. So that is completely on BTP, and then the finance is on S4. Now, combination of both will give a higher business value. And therefore, the interoperability between various SAP applications and S4 becomes very important. And this is where the value of BTP comes into picture. And then customers or partners can have their own smaller applications, which are specific to their industry, and run it along with S4HANA. So this is where interoperability helps. Okay. So, I mean, we can see or have some examples of what are the integration possibilities, integration suite, SAP Business Hub, API Business Hub, then API management, cloud integration, integration advisor, and open connectors. A lot of integration possibilities are there. Then data to value has SAP HANA Cloud, then Warehouse Cloud, SAC comes into picture, then data intelligence come into picture, then extensibility, as we talked, is more kind of extension, thus S4HANA success factor, or probably any other solution, right? So example, we have even extended non-SAP application on BTP. And so example, let's we have example GEP, right? If I need to extend GEP for certain features which has to be integrated with S4, then I can use the SAP BTP as a central place, which can extend a small feature of GEP, but it looks more kind of SAP as it is connecting to SAP. So different possibilities, different options. Any questions here?
Yeah, we have some questions on the chat. So what is, how BTP is different from SCP?
So SCP was earlier the cloud platform, which was more from a technical perspective. I mean, it was giving possibilities to create or extend the applications or create new applications. But BTP is more wider. I mean, if you say, it is not only talking about, let's say, a particular technology, it's talk about different things. Example, it is saying that you can have industry solutions, right? So it is giving a vision of entire framework into one particular place. It's not just specific to a technology which says, you can build a UI application, or you can build connected or extend a standard S4 application. So BTP is kind of a, I mean, as such, it's a rebranding of SAP Cloud Platform, but then it is more bigger and more wider and cover more areas. I mean, if you see here in this particular site, this is taken from SAP.com, right? So if you see, even now SAP is considering SAP BW4HANA inside your BTP as a technology platform. And if you see here, MDG is also being considered now as part of BTP. So it's more kind of a bigger platform than SAP Cloud Platform.
So we can say that SAP was a start for SAP, then SAP moved into BTP with introducing more stuff, more applications, more SaaS solutions, more out of SAP's BTP, right? That could be a generalized term.
Yeah.
There's another question. What is SAP RUM? R-U-M-M, R-U-M-M.
Yes, there is option of run. I am not sure. I haven't worked on it. If anyone else knows answer to that. Unfortunately, never even got chance to read it out thoroughly.
Yeah, hi, I can answer that. So SAP RUM is basically a tool or application which you can say provided by SAP, in which if it is between a team, so we can add task or collaborate between the team to do some work. So it's basically a platform where you can communicate within your team. Your manager can add task on your name. You can complete that. So it would be informed to everyone. So it's a tool which is provided by SAP.
Thanks, Amrit. So Pranav, we can continue.
Okay. So we just talked about what exactly BTP is and how does it fit into SAP vision of intelligent enterprise. Now let's see how can we get started with BTP. What are the licensing options that we have? So if you see, there are four, basically from licensing perspective, there are three major options, and fourth one is more kind of a trial option that we have. So the first one is pay as you go. So it's a more agile way of bringing the platform for production use. Basically you can start with free. You can create a account, productive account for free, and then you can even use certain services. When I see it, it's almost all the services, but with a limit. So example, if I'm using Application Studio with a free tier, I can probably have only two developers. So that's a limit on the free tier, but it still is a productive environment, unlike a free trial. So as I'm writing it over here, so it's a free tier to start with no upfront cost. There is no financial commitments, and it's a productive environment. So it's a very good option to actually start SAP BTP in a production environment and build something and move it to production. And probably, if need more, then it's very agile. We can even add more services, add more. Let's say, as I was saying, Business Application Studio has two developers limit, but if we can add more, we just need to pay for the additional developers that we are onboarding, additional usages that we are doing. So yeah, then there's a CPEA model, which is consumption of cloud credits. Now again, this is applicable to the enterprise account. Now, what happens is when, let's say, a customer is trying to get the wider, has a wider vision that they will use BTP probably for the entire enterprise using a lot of services. So they talk to sales representative for SAP and get certain cloud credits. Probably, let's say, cloud credits is kind of a consumption which you can do for almost every service, but there's a fixed amount to it. So let's say we have 100k, the 100k corresponding cloud credits is being given to customer, and then every service has a way of using those cloud credits, and it's there on the internet how the cloud credits for a particular service works. Now when we start using those services, these cloud credits are consumed from our wider range, and then it becomes more agile. Right? We can use any of the services. We don't have to inform SAP beforehand that we're going to use this particular services only. So it's also a very good option when we have a bigger picture with customer, when they know that they are going to have a very good usage of BTP in coming few years. I know most of the services are covered in CPA, but probably some of the new services, and last one that I know was WorkZone, which was not covered under CPA, but probably over time it also will move into CPA model, or it's already been moved. I'm not sure of that, but not necessary that every service will be there, but 95% of the services will be covered in CPA model. Then subscription based model. Again, it's kind of a la carte. So you can choose with a contract that I want to use, let's say, Cloud Foundry, then I want to use Launchpad service with it, and I probably am going to use the workflow service. So I don't use any other. And then you can have to that contract with a fixed rate with SAP, and optimize your cost. And there are possibility to modify this contract either with SAP Store or with SAP representative, sales representative. So
broadly, then, I think we can say subscription based model is something where we can negotiate with SAP. We can have our own cost or something, but CPA model is something where SAP has predefined cost where you buy credits and you consume that. So I think that's the major difference between subscription based model and CPA, right?
I think CPA also is negotiable because it's like 100k that you're giving to SAP, but how much credits you are getting? Probably you're getting credits of 125k, right? So in terms of that, it is also negotiable. It just depends on the customer that that is going to use it, right? And what is the relation with SAP and all those things.
Got it.
Then the last one is the free trial, which is applicable to all of us, and we can happily use it. The only difference between free trial and free tier is that free trial is not a productive usage. So you can use this free trial account to learn to develop applications. But if you have to move this application from free trial to productive usage, it is like a starting over again. So either you, if it's export, you can export it into your productive environment, or you have to start again. And there's a duration to it. I think 30 days or after 30 days, the free trial has to be deleted, or if you're not using it for 30 days, it has to be deleted. There are some conditions.
So initially when you sign up for free trial, nowadays it is 365 days. And it keeps on extending 30 days if you are active on the free trial account. So suppose I have signed up now and I'm left with only 13 days. I log in, I am again active, it will automatically extend it for 30 days. So this is how the free trial account works as of now.
Yes, okay. So this is about the licensing options.
Pranav, I have one doubt here. So I just had been into a scenario where the customer, client have on-premise Fiori, and we need to develop some custom applications. I am used to develop applications on Web IDE, so, but the customer hasn't, do not have the subscription for BTP Neo environment, and they are just insisting to use VS Code or Eclipse or something like, which is available without a subscription. So in that case, if I go to develop the application on my personal account, I mean trial account, Web ID or personal Web ID, local Web ID, and later on, push it to the on-premise system, will it attract any audit issues or something like that?
Interesting. So free trial accounts are not actually meant to create productive applications. So I don't know how it is trackable. Probably it is trackable some way, but and then it's a customer also, right? If they are asking to not use the Web ID, then
they are just not interested to buy the subscription for BAS or Web ID. They are just not interested, but they have on-premise Fiori license.
But okay, but Web ID is on Neo, and what I know, Web ID doesn't has a lot of cost to it. Probably it's free for usage if we.
Okay, so there is also a local version of Web ID which you can install on your system and you can continue.
Yeah, that was my point. If I install the local personal Web ID and use that Web ID to push the application on on-premise system, will it create any issues at the time of audit?
As per current understanding, I don't think so. It will attract any cost or any licensing issues, because Web ID is a tool which is ideally free to develop. But when you have to deploy something on SAP Cloud Platform, or then you need a subscription, because then it will be a different ballgame altogether.
But for your local... I just want to push it on on-premise system as a BSP. So I guess that would be good to go, right?
Anmol, the issue is how will you maintain this code, right? You deploy it to on-premise, okay, and then if you need to change, you again go to your trial account, right?
Right.
So then your trial account is actually containing your customer's code, your customer's development. Right. This is what the issue is, yeah. So because a customer owns its own code development and all, and it should not be kind of shared on a public basis, because the trial account anyone can access, right? You know, SAP can look at the code and all if they want. That's not as secure as it could be, I think.
And probably
so
the
for Visual Studio Code or Eclipse in that case. What would be the exact recommendation at this point? So what should be the good path to go?
See, ideally you can use any of the tools. You can have your local repository on GitHub, which your client you can use, right? So that's how you can manage if you don't want to have a subscription. But it is ideally recommended not to use your free trial account for custom developments.
Okay.
You can have your GitHub to control your code versioning. That's how you can control versioning and you can manage developing locally.
Okay. Got it. Thank you.
Yeah, Pranav, you can continue.
Okay.
Yeah, so there is another question. Is it possible to create additional sub accounts in BTP trial?
Sub accounts we can try to create. I haven't tried it actually, but spaces you can create multiple spaces. Sub accounts probably not, but we can try it in the demo. We can try to create if there is an option to create sub account.
Okay, so Mohit says yes, we can. Okay, so let's continue.
Okay, so this is the representation of how the global accounts, sub accounts, and the various environments are linked. Now, if you see, the global account is actually our contract with SAP. So, like we have seen previously, right? So, any of these licensing options that we choose falls or goes into the global account, and this is where the billing will happen from. Now, global account can handle multiple regions via the different sub accounts. Then it can have multiple admins, but the licensing type is only one, if you see, as represented here. So you can have, with one global account, you can either have a CPA or you can have a subscription or any other. If you want to have more than one licensing types, then probably create more global accounts. Then sub accounts, right? So one global account can have multiple sub accounts, and every sub account is linked to a particular region. So I can have a sub account specific to a Europe region or a US region in one particular global account, but the sub account will always be of that specific region. And then we can have multiple admins in the sub account level. We can connect the IDP to handle the business user, and by default SAP IDP option is also there. I mean, that's coming by default with SAP. So we can log in to global accounts with our SID, and even to the services that we subscribe, we can use the SIDs to log in. And then other option is to use the IDP based login. Then we have multiple environments linked to a sub account. So we can have Kaima, Neo, Cloud Foundry, WAP. So Neo, I think a lot of people are moving out of Neo to CF. Then ABAP is still picking up, and Kaim also is something which is picking up. It's very new in terms of usage. And I'm not sure how many customers are using the entire, all the four environments, but most of the customers definitely are going with Cloud Foundry. Okay, moving to the next one. So
before we proceed, maybe it's a very premature question. So what's the basic difference between Cloud Foundry and Neo?
So Neo is SAP provided environment, which SAP started very early with Cloud Platform. Cloud Foundry is like a general Cloud Foundry environment, which is more open source, and you can develop the applications like you can do on AWS. It's a very open environment, which gives a lot of flexibility to develop different kind of applications.
So we can say basically it's an advanced version of initial Neo.
I won't relate two of them. I won't say that it's an advanced version of Neo. Neo is SAP specific environment, which was built specifically by SAP to have developments on Cloud Platform. Cloud Foundry is open source concept, which is being used by not only SAP, but other players as well. So it's a generic development environment where you can have spaces, applications, services running on that particular environment. You can have applications deployed into that particular space. You can have multiple spaces. You can control the administration of that particular space. You can control the administration of applications being deployed on that space. You can control the usage or the quota that can be assigned to a specific application. It's a more open source than Neo.
Okay, thank you. So there is another question from Nilesh. Why Neo environment is discontinued? Any specific, we have reasons from SAP? Or it's just
I haven't heard that it is discontinued. It's still being used, and probably there is a plan to move it to Cloud Foundry everything, but people are still using it, and I know certain clients who are still using Neo, and probably I asked this question 1 year back to SAP, that is there a statement from SAP that Neo is going out? That time there was no statement that Neo is going out. Probably this is just a talk in the market that Neo is going out. For now, at least I have not heard official statement that Neo will die soon. If someone else, probably Gaurav or someone else who has heard any official statement.
Okay. Yeah, we can continue.
Okay. So, yes, this is the, now we are going into the, towards the demo of BTP. So therefore, a glimpse of what are different services available on BTP. I mean, if you see, there are almost 90 services in the Discovery Center. So if you go to this, you can, where is my scroll bar? Okay, the scroll bar is not coming up. So you can see all the different services that are applicable on BTP. And you can explore the services. probably the major use services would be workflow, business rule, audit logging, then alert notification, and Cloud Foundry is not a service, it's not a SaaS service, but it's a it's environment, so you can deploy your UI5 or your CAPM and all those things. So those would be another major important services that would come into picture. Event mesh, launchpad service, so a lot of them, which when it comes to end-to-end usage will play important part. So probably you can explore certain services from here, but starting with a smaller one. Okay. Cloud TMS is also important service which come into place when we start moving our applications from one tier to the next tier, from dev to test to quality to production. So yeah, and if you see, there are marking over here which is free tier. So whichever service you see marked as free tier is available with the free tier, which is the first option that we have seen in the licensing option. Rest of the services probably are not available right now with free tier, but I assume all of these would someday be part of free tier. Okay. Okay, probably this is the last slide. Yes, so we go into trial. Probably the linkage is not right. I'll copy it. So I already created a trial account day before yesterday. Now, if I hope you know how to create a trial account. If not, then when you hit this URL, you can sign up with your SID, and that's it. Then it gives you an option to create the trial account. When you move further, it gives you an option to select a region where you want to access the sub account, and that's it. And then account is ready. Then you will reach this particular page. From here, you can navigate inside the account, and this would be the first page that or similar page that you would see. Now, I think there was an question on if we can create multiple sub accounts. So yeah, let us see. Yes, it's giving an option, so we can try to test it out. Demo domain, hope it's not mandatory. So I think I already have this one from Europe, so we can create a different one. Probably US, and parent account description not required. Okay. So yes, then it gives you an option to have multiple sub accounts. Recently, there's an option to create directories. Probably not available for everyone right now in all the regions. But this is available with feature set B. So if you go here and if you click on account information, so you will see, so there are two things. One of them you would see, either you would see feature set A or feature set B. So feature set B is the new way of managing the accounts that SAP has brought up recently. It provides a lot of different features. We are also still in the exploring part of it. But one of the major difference that I noted is the option to create directories. Now, earlier what used to happen is when we create sub-accounts. So when we create sub-accounts, you will have a list of, we'll end up being a big list. And in one of the customer, we had around 70 sub-accounts. And then it becomes really difficult to for an administrator to manage those sub-accounts. Now, that's one of the difference that I have noticed with feature set B, that you can create directories and then you can arrange the sub-accounts into the directories. So if you see here, so I've created this directory yesterday and or day before yesterday and added the first sub-account that I had into this. And then it becomes more manageable for me to have multiple sub-accounts. It's kind of a folder structure where I can manage. Then,
Okay. So it's kind of managing your account.
Yes, that's one of the differences that I have noticed, and probably there are others. So when we go into the detailed documentation of feature set B, it gives more details, like because it is impacting the authorization also. So currently, to log into a global account or the cockpit, I need to have SID. So that's the only way where I can log in. But with feature set B, coming releases, the SAP will also give an option to integrate the IDP. So then I don't have to use SAP IDP to log in. I can use, let's say, customer's IDP to log in. And then account becomes more customer specific. So and there are more features to it. So probably can try to explore it further if you are interested in exploring the features.
Okay. Basically, like we have, as per my understanding, like in case we have a multiple sub accounts and all, and we have a big organization and bigger and the various departments like finance, HR, payroll, like this thing. So we can group basically those particular sub accounts into that particular directory. So so basically we can monitor the service uses, day space allocation and all those things under a directory which is allocated to a particular sub account. So basically we are making a separate group for the different functionality or the different department wise to basically manage it properly. Yeah.
And do we means move one apps or applications from one sub account to another sub account within a global account?
You can move applications, so that's something which we usually do, right? So so example, I can have one sub account for let's say development, and then another one would be for test or quality or production. So yes, we can move the applications from sub-accounts to sub-accounts. I mean, the applications are deployed on space level and space is inside the sub-account. So VRXS essentially moving it from one space to other space. Probably workflow and all those are different. But yes, between sub-accounts, it's possible to move the applications. And sometimes it's become legal requirement also to have different sub accounts. Example, we cannot have the data from EU region to go into a US sub account, right? So then it becomes important to have a dedicated sub account for EU region and a dedicated sub account for let's say US region. Similarly, is the case with China. We cannot have a data center outside China. So then it is important to have the sub accounts in that particular region specified by government and authorities, right? So then it becomes also important to have different sub-accounts, different regions. And then again, there are some new requirements that even the person who is maintaining a particular data center should be inside that particular region. I think it's a new requirement of China requirement, one of them. And yes, having all those directories and then different things would definitely help to control the entire BTP centrally, but still make it more agile. And okay, then
can we share or publish our applications within the sub account? Kind of.
Can we share? I mean, what do you mean by share?
Means, let's say I develop an application from this particular using the trial account or something, right? For further use of other clients or other projects within a company, right? So can I share those or reuse those applications that I have created within sub account or a global account, right? Means kind of we are using the app library and kind of means we are generally doing in API management, right? Where we can publish our APIs for others can be used. So whatever application here we are developing can be publish or share here.
You mean you want to monetize the application? Like you can monetize the API in a similar way, you want to monetize a particular application?
Yes, kind of.
I think the industry solution that the concept of industry cloud talks about the similar thing, right? So you can create your industry specific applications and then it can be monetized, I think. That's the concept of industry cloud, that you create your industry specific application, probably something specific to pharma or something specific to manufacturing industry, and then monetize it.
Okay.
Let me also try to add Paras here. So based on my understanding, you are asking, can we share application across different sets of users or not, who are not sharing the same global account or same sub account, correct?
Correct, Mohit.
Yes, so the answer is yes, we can share it. So once the application is exposed or deployed, it can be used across anywhere. In fact, I can develop a application in my cloud BTP portal and I can share the URL with you. If you have the authorized, if I have not set up any access authorization or something, so you can directly able to access my that application also. So yes, it can be used across multiple accounts, and this thing, it is nothing to do with the sub account level and the global account. Once the your application is deployed and we have a proper we have the proper URL or endpoint for it, so you can access it from anywhere, from any account. Yeah, if you have proper authorization. Is this answer your question?
Yes, Mike. Thank you.
Okay, thank you.
Okay. So moving on to the next set of things. So SAP provides certain boosters which you can use to jumpstart the setting of certain services. So example, I mean, you can see certain booster over here. Now, one of them would be SAP workflow management. Now, if you apply this particular booster, what it will do is it will create an instance for the workflow management. It will create instance for business rule. Business rule is coming inside the workflow management now. And with certain clicks, you don't even have to go into the space level, create all those instances, but probably click of start and XXX, it will make this the space ready for you to do developments for workflow, for business rule. So these boosters are really helpful if you want to, or it even creates the destinations for you, which can be used on the when using the workflow via inboxes and all those things. So use the boosters to jumpstart, to quickly do some developments if needed. So these are really helpful. Then entitlements. So here you can so we go for the trial one. You can choose a particular sub account where you want to see all the entitlements. So since it's a trial account, most of the entitlements are already been added when I created the sub account. Then based on the licensing conditions that we have for the actual productive usage, you will see probably less or more. So it typically depends on that. Then service assignment is again, which are the services that I can use and the quota that is assigned. For trial, it's a different way, but for productive usage, it can be completely different. Then usage analytics is basically an analytics on what is, how the BTP is being used. So it gives you more details on how you will be charged over a particular duration, and you can track all the usage here. So if you see, I created a kind of runtime on the sub account. It's showing me over here. Then it's completely empty. I don't have much in it, so therefore nothing much in the analytics. But when you use it, actually you will see it on a monthly basis, how it grows. So navigating to the sub account. Now there are multiple options in the at the sub account level. So first one, and which is more important, is the services. So this is where you can see all the available services that we have seen in the service catalog. Based on the need, you can create an instance of it and use it. So example, if I need to use, let's say, Event Mesh, I can create an instance of it. Let's say a standard one. And it takes some time to create the instance, and then the instance is available over here like this. Now you need to see, because this is the front end or the SaaS application for the Event Mesh. This is not the actual technical instance. The technical instance we create in the at the space level. So this instance is more kind of for managing this Event Mesh with a application that SAP provides, and it needs certain roles to access the application. So if you see, all the roles that are required are coming up here, and then you can go to, I'll show you later on how you can assign the roles, and from there you can access the Event Mesh as an application. Now to use the Event Mesh, you need to technically create an instance of it in the at the space level, which you will see later, which then enables you to subscribe to the events coming from S4, and you can publish it to any other subscriber if required.
Just to add a couple of points here, this Event Mesh is particularly used, means it can be hundreds of various use cases or scenario. But I have recently used this Event Mesh for triggering the S4 basically like the BTP workflows, right? Like on creation of sales order or purchase order, we want our BTP workflow to start, right? So in this scenario, we can configure the event mesh and all those things. So it is very useful service for capturing the events and all those things. Yeah.
Yeah. So it's a very new integration pattern. And I think, if I'm not wrong, it is now even available with ECC. So even if you don't have S4 HANA, even if you have ECC, you can try to use event mesh integration. Okay, so basically instance and subscription is nothing but you can have those SaaS services from the catalog. You can create the instance of it and then you can access the applications out of it. So example, Business Application Studio, which is for developers, is also coming as an instance. And I mean, if you go here in the three arrows and click on go to application, this would open the App Studio for you. Okay. Yes. And this is my App Studio. Similarly is a Launchpad service. So if I go to application, it opens up the Launchpad service and I can create my sites and portal and all those things for end users to work with, similar to Fury Launchpad. So any question here? Probably this is the, so really people who are seeing it for the first time, this might be confusing. So any question here?
I have one question. Is the Cloud Foundry Launchpad somehow different from Neo Portal Service?
Yes, it is different. Both are different. So Launchpad Service is on the cloud platform on CF side of it. Neo is completely a different service. And SAP is now projecting Launchpad Service here as a central launchpad for the entire enterprise. For example, you can even integrate S4, you can integrate your EWM, you can integrate applications from a cloud platform into a single service, and then it becomes your central launchpad.
Okay.
For the entire enterprise. I mean, kind of a portal concept, but yes, it's different.
Okay, thank you.
And way of creation of the content also is different in the Launchpad service. So, and further to the Launchpad service is the work zone, which is encapsulating the Launchpad service in it using the Launchpad service feature, but provides more portal capabilities.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, then the environment that we have here is the Cloud Foundry environment. Now, space. So spaces are the place where, which is more for the developers to develop and deploy the applications. Now you can create as many spaces as you want and based on the strategy of a particular customer, you can have specific space for a specific project or a specific space for a specific set of applications, a specific set of users, a specific set of vendor, right? So, and every space will have its own quota. And then you can create applications, deploy applications. So creation of application is via Business Application Studio. Then you can deploy it inside the space. And this is where the application will actually run from. So, there is no quota plan assigned to this particular space, but if we create a quota plan in the sub account level, then you can assign the quota plan to a specific space and yeah, to control it better probably. Then org members, it's more members which are applicable to that particular space. Now I can create more org members. Probably in trial account it is not possible. I haven't tried it, adding more of my colleagues in the in my space. But in the actual productive usage, you will have a lot of people working on the same space. So you can add more people and add more roles to it. Okay. So when we use the actual, okay, let's see it from here. Space level, if it shows the members. Okay, yes, here. So, okay, from sub account level, it is only showing the option to have manager and auditor at the org level. But when you go inside the space level, you can have specific roles even for the developer. So then you don't have to give a space manager role to every developer. You can for developers, you can restrict it to developer if restriction is required, or else you can assign the space manager and space auditor role as well. Okay, going back to the sub account. Then HTML5 applications, when you deploy applications on the space, if it's coming from the manager operator, applications are visible over here. You can use, then this can be used inside the Launchpad service to directly create a tile out of it. And yeah, I mean, it's being deployed on the space, just it's visible over here. Then connectivity, this is more to create the destinations to connect to backend systems or any API that we want to use from API Business Hub or anywhere else, right? So then cloud connector is again a component which we install on premise. I don't have any on trial account, but it is actually so kind of a proxy, reverse proxy, which connects your backend system. You connect the backend system and cloud connector, and then cloud connector is connected to your BTP. So then your application is using destination. Destination is navigating via cloud connector, and a cloud connector is going further to your backend box to actually connect any OData service or any probably Mule service or REST service or anything else. Security, so this is where you can assign the roles. Now users is nothing, but you can add more users to it. I on the trial account, I'm not sure if you can add more users, but in the actual productive environment, you can add as many users as you want. So just create on it, provide the email ID, give the identity provider. Right now it's default coming up because we don't have any provider configured with trial account, so it's going with SAP identity provider. But with any business actually client scenario, right, so it would be probably a identity provider from the client, and then you can choose the identity provider and create a user. Then role collection is actually the place where we see all the roles by default which are coming when we instantiate a particular service in the service marketplace that we have seen earlier. Now, if you see here, when I added the enterprise messaging or event-based service, it is creating a certain role collection by default for me. Now I can add.
I don't know, Akash, sorry to interrupt you. Yeah. So all these activities in an active productive environment will be divided into different people, right? Everybody might not be having access to everything, so it is good to know all these things. But when you talk about productive environment, this would be ideally divided between different roles, correct?
Probably yes. It depends on the client as well, right? So probably there would be one administrator who has access to all of them, and then there is an authorization team which is specifically looking into security. Then there is a team which looks specifically into let's say enabling a service. Then there is a team which is doing development. So yes, I mean, segregation of duties would be there. Yeah.
Okay, thank you.
Should be there. I mean, I'm not saying it would be, but it should be there. But it depends on a particular client.
Agreed.
Okay, yes. And navigating further. Now, this is where actually you can assign a role to yourself and use it. So if like we have added the event mesh, but if I try to access that application, for now, it won't allow me to access. So what I can do is, I can probably try to use it from here. And see if I... Okay. So this is the current role that I have. I can add more. I can add event enterprise messaging, probably all of them. Let's say this also. And now when I add these roles, now if I go back to my application instance over here, and now I should be able to access the event mesh cockpit. Yes. So, but if I don't have any roles assigned, then either it will give me an authorized message over here, or it will not even open up the page. So, yeah, this is where you start with when you try to access the application. Probably it would be useful in your trial when you try to access different applications. Any application that you add will by default add a role collection. If it doesn't, then it will add roles, and probably you need to create a role collection and add all those roles in it, and then assign the role collection to your user.
Got it.
So yeah, so it's kind of a role collection is more encapsulating all the different roles that is applicable for a particular application, and then role collection is assigned to a user, and then the application is accessible. Okay. If I go to the space level, nothing very fancy at the space level, just few things. Again, you can see option to have a service marketplace and instance. Now this is more technical. So the one that we have seen in the sub account is more SaaS applications, and one that we see over here, the instances here is more technical. So any application that you deploy will come over here. And if you want to use a particular service with any of your application, you need to create an instance of that service over here. So when we navigated to Event Mesh, you don't see any message clients over here, right? The reason is the application is just kind of an overview of what you can do, but it actually is not technically ready for you to use. Now to make it technically ready, you need to create an instance of Event Mesh inside your space. So if I go here and if I create an instance, probably default. Yeah, okay. Instance. Next. It needs a specific JSON, which you will see on help.sap. not every service would need a JSON, but event mesh certainly needs a specific JSON that should be added before we create an instance. So we will name it instance control C. I think this should be same. Unique ID can be anything. Let's say demo organization can be trial for now. And we create next and create again. Ensure that service plan exists is access to it. Okay, probably the standard plan is not available with the trial account. So let's see if it is something is there which we can use. Okay, service. Let's go inside the service account only.
Pranav, sorry to interrupt you. The another 5 minutes of your session ending.
Yeah. So probably it's only available with the dev. So yes. So technically, you need to have the dev type of instance creation over there, and then when you actually try to use the instance of Event Mesh. This is technically where you need to integrate the instance that we are going to create over here with your S4 system, and then all the events which are published by S4 or ECCs can be captured in the event mesh, and it's available for you to use. So more or less done. Any specific questions that I can answer?
Anybody, any questions you have in your mind which you would like to discuss?
Hi Pranav, this is Subha here. So after the sunset of this Cloud Foundry, so do we still use Cloud Foundry or with a subscription, or we develop on the BTP?
I am not sure if I got the question right. So Cloud Foundry is not going down. I mean, that's the new environment which will stay. So you need Cloud Foundry anyways. You need one particular runtime to develop your application. It can be Cloud Foundry, it can be Chimera, it can be Neo, but you need one environment. So for now, CF is the environment which is widely used, and
okay,
it's not there is no plan to sunset it. I know.
Okay, thank you.
Pranav, I have one question. So is there any possibility to migrate the applications, the HTML5 application and portal site from Neo to CF as of now?
Yes, a lot of people are migrating. I think there are some blogs as well on how to migrate from Neo to CF. It's not a direct migration because the way of developing the applications in Neo and CF is a bit different. Mm-hmm. But when you follow certain steps, it is possible to migrate. And when you Google, I mean, you will see certain blogs which will tell you how to migrate.
Okay.
So I think this BTP cockpit, it's more like with like Azure, Microsoft Azure and GCP Cloud, right? We are having, so it's kind of same service marketplace and everything, spaces and all it is providing as of now, right? So it's trying to build parallel in that.
Yes. And so there are different service providers. AWS is one of them. GCP is another one. They provide the data center. SAP also provides its own data center. Then Azure also. So yeah, I mean, as a platform, as a service is by SAP. And then you can use any of the platform providers. It can be AWS or GCP or anything, which is available in the region which you want to use for. So not necessary that every provider is available in every region. So, but it's a client preference where they want to go.
Paras, I'm not sure if I have got your question correct or wrong, but both are actually different. Actually, this BTP is actually the platform as a service, PaaS actually, and the GCP, Azure, AWS, and these are basically infrastructure provider. So basically the BTP is developed on either, means you need some runtime environment. It is either basically you need some infrastructure to host your those services, right? So those infrastructure provider is a GCP or AWS, Microsoft, Azure, and all. But BTP is a platform as a service. So they are giving you some ready-made built-up service like your business application studio, ABAP, EventBase, and so on, right? So both are from the different perspective.
Yes, basically, yeah. Means Azure and Azure itself also providing IaaS and PaaS and other services on their platform as well. Likewise, BTP, I think it's using Kubernetes as a container for installing those instances and other applications, right? So I'm just saying, means it's running in parallel and on the same way, like we have Azure and GCP. So SAP is also moving in that particular way to introducing their BTP platform, right?
BTP won't provide us the infrastructure.
Yeah, that's BTP, fine. Yeah. Means, but it's it means whatever its look and feel or the way it is representing. So it's means basically matching to those things, right? I have right. gone through that as yours, so it looks the same feel here.
Right. Probably right. Azure yeah. is more or Azure is less enterprise ready, I would say, than BTP. Because the services that are available on BTP are focused specifically for SAP technologies. So it's from that perspective, BTP is more enterprise ready than or ERP ready. I will not say enterprise ready.
Yeah, ERP because BTP. SAP is itself is main in ERP, so it's towards in the ERP side.
Yeah. So. So providers like AWS also, they also have a similar set of services, right? They have database as a service, or they have document management systems, they have workflows and all those things, but probably not as close to ERP as SAP is with BTP.
Yes, on ERP standpoint, it's on top of it.
And I have one question. Like Pranav said that SAP has its own data center. Is that because the infrastructure is on Azure or AWS, so the data center is SAP has its own data center, or the data is stored when they use the cloud of Azure or Amazon?
I didn't get the question. Say again, please.
When you say, like you said that SAP also has its own data center like Azure or Amazon, AWS. But what I've seen that when we have to create the instance and we need to select which data center we'd like to use. So generally the BTP is using only the Amazon or Google or Microsoft's data center, right?
Right. For CF environment, I think for Neo, SAP has its own data center, right?
Don't yeah, right.
Neo
right,
is
right,
available
right.
on.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. For Cloud Foundry, we have Amazon and Google and Microsoft. But for Neo, they used to use their own. But seems like they're shifting from that. So they're probably, providing yes. platform as a service, and for the infrastructure side, they are. Relying on the cloud providers.
Yeah, probably is. So probably that is the main reason they want to go out of Neo. Probably they don't want to provide the infrastructure. But it's more SAP strategy.
Agreed. So any more questions from anybody? Or Pranav, I would say that was a very, very good session, and to be very in detail and in precise whatever information everybody was looking. So even for newcomers and even for people who have already been using trial account or have some knowledge of BTP, it definitely has enhanced our understanding of SAP BTP. So So any topic team, anybody wants to discuss about any new topic, any questions from anywhere from SAP world, we would like to have a 15 minutes discussion on any of the topics which we want to discuss. Anything you want to know new?
I have one doubt. I'm not sure if I'm troubling everyone so much, but I have one question from theory perspective. Can I go ahead for that?
Yes, please.
Okay. So I am implementing few applications, few standard applications. So the major obstacle that is coming is from the roles part. So I have created custom groups and catalogs. We don't want to use the standard roles. So what should be the best practice to create the roles to avoid any of the SU53 logs? Means there are some objects that are creating the authorization issues. So what could be the best way to avoid these? Means how I can make sure that no authorization issues are coming to the users? That's my question.
I think probably you should start with copying the standard ones, and then you should modify it, because standard objects would have most of the things already built up and already taken care. So if you don't want to use standard, you want to use your custom, I would recommend start copying first standard and then do your modifications.
Okay.
Don't create anything from the scratch, because most of the things will be already incorporated in standard objects. So you need to first understand what standard object has the limitation which is not fulfilling you. You add that limitation, and something which standard object is by default providing, you want to restrict, then you can do it in your custom code. But do not create anything from scratch. Copy from standard and then do the modifications. That will basically limit you the errors which you will have. Definitely, you would need to do an end-to-end screening and testing, but that will at least save a lot of time for you.
Okay, got it. Thank you.
So any topic anybody would like to hear from the team from next month discussion? Anybody, any new topic in your mind, anything you would like to?
If anybody has been working on BRF Plus, that would be good. I've been trying to search a few things on BRF Plus, but I have a lot of questions. So if anybody is expert in the group in BRF Plus, that would be good.
Okay. So one topic for BRF Plus. Any other topic would anybody would like to hear? Okay. So nominations are open for next month. So you can reach out to me, Mohit, Nabeet, or Gaurav, anybody. You have a number, or you can directly reach out to Nabeet. So anybody would like to present on BRF Plus or any other topic, please free to open. Please free to reach out to us. Then we will connect with you on separately. So thank you all. Thank you all for joining this session. It's a great session by Pranav. I hope to have further entertaining sessions and further knowledgeable sessions in next meetings. Thank you all. Thank you for your time.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.